Welcome to calculus. So today's the 12th or something. Last time we were talking about Lagrange multipliers, so we'll do one more of this kind before we move on to a new topic. So here's an example. So find the min and max of x cubed plus 2xy plus 4y squared subject to x plus 2y is 12. Using the method of Lagrange multipliers. Okay, so in the language, in the method of Lagrange multipliers, there's three functions involved. What are their names?
X, Y, and lambda.
X, Y, and lambda are going to be the variables, but what are the names of the functions?
Constraint.
The constraint is one of them. The objective. And what else? Yeah, the Lagrange function, sometimes called the Lagrangian. Okay, so then what is the objective in this exercise, the objective function? Okay, so I don't mean the objective in the English sense. I mean objective in the...
x third plus 2xy plus 4y squared.
Right. So the objective function is usually called little f, and in this exercise it is x cubed plus 2xy plus 4y squared. That is the function that you're instructed to optimize. What is the constraint function? Right. To make it a constraint function, you need a function so that when you set the function equal to zero, that's equivalent to the original constraint equation. So that is to say, you take the constraint equation, you move everything to one side so that you have zero on the other side. So x plus 2y minus 12. And you could have moved everything to the right-hand side, but then you'd have negative step. Okay, then what is the Lagrange function, what do you want to call it? We can use any letter. Big L? Okay, so how about big L? What are its variables? X, Y, and lambda. Again, why did we pick lambda specifically? Why that letter? Yeah, because the guy's name is Lagrange, and lambda is the Greek phonetic equivalent of L. That's the only reason for using that letter. The Lagrange function is then always the objective minus a multiple of the constraint. So the objective minus a multiple of the constraint. And just to refresh our memories, why is this called the method of Lagrange multipliers? Yeah. Yeah, because you got this lambda, and it's multiplying the constraint. So the method of Lagrange multipliers. Okay, so now that we have identified the three functions, the objective constraint and Lagrangian, what do we do from here? Simplify this? Yeah, we could. But what? We're supposed to do something.
Stationary points.
Of what?
L.
Of L. So now we want to find the stationary points of the Lagrange function. Okay, and the result that we're using is that the optimal points for the objective, they have to be among the stationary points of the Lagrangian. So we're just going to find the stationary points, and then those have to be the answers to the exercise. So how do you find the stationary points of a function? Good.
And then set them all equal to zero.
Right. All partials must be equal to zero. Okay. So then how many partials will big L have?
Three.
Why will it have three partials? Because it has three variables. Okay. So the x partial, well, that will be 3x squared. And then 2y, 0, and then minus lambda x. So what is the x partial of negative lambda x?
Negative
lambda. So L sub y now. So the y partial, that'd be 0 plus 2x. Plus 8y, and then minus 2 lambda, and the lambda partial will be negative that thing. Okay, any question about computing the partials? This is okay. This one? Because concerning just this part in parentheses, what is the x partial of this? So just this part, what's its x partial? It'd be 1, right? Because it's 1x and then constant. So the x partial of this term in parentheses is 1. So you would just get 1 lambda. And then what's the y partial of this? 2. So for the y partial, you'd get 2 lambda. Okay. Other questions? If that's not comfortable, then you can multiply this out and collect and then compute the partials.
But what I was asking is, what is the negative?
Because of that negative right there.
And then what about the 12?
The x partial and the y partial will be 0. Right. So that's, if you were to distribute this, this would be negative lambda x minus 2 lambda y plus 12 lambda. Okay, so now we need to solve all of these equal to 0 in a system. So 3x squared plus 2y minus lambda is 0. 2x plus 8y minus 2 lambda is 0. And x plus 2y minus 12 is 0. Okay, so now, okay, you tell me what happened to it. So I think you're saying, you know, why did I do it like this? So what if this was an equation and I multiplied both sides by negative 1? What if this said equal to 0 and I multiplied both sides by negative 1? Then it'd be exactly the same. Okay, so we want to solve this system. What are we going to do?
We're going to pick 1 and solve for lambda.
Solve for lambda. Okay, so when I was doing this last week, I was using arrows and that kind of thing, and now I'm going to do a slightly different strategy, a slightly different bookkeeping strategy, just so you can see that there's a variety of strategies in common use. So I'm going to number these equations. 1, 2, and 3. So now I'm going to, I'll use equation 1. And from equation 1, I can solve for lambda. So now that's lambda is 3x squared?
Plus 2y.
And what can I do with this?
Plug it into.
Yeah, so now I'll put that into 2. Putting that into 2, so that's 2x plus 8y minus 2, and then 3x squared plus 2y. Equal to 0. So now that equation is sort of like the worst one on the page, but actually it's a nice position to be in, because what have we achieved? Yeah, now this is an equation with two variables in it. It doesn't have any lambdas. So that's good. So let's simplify this. So 2x plus 8y minus 6x squared minus 4y squared is 0. So collecting things and sorting them into order. How about negative 6x squared plus 2x plus 4y is 0. Okay. Now what?
Solve for y.
Okay. So since we're going to start using this equation, I'll give it a number so we can refer to it by number. So you're saying, so essentially what we haven't used yet is we have not used equations 3 and 4. Right?
Wait,
so,
what?
Sorry?
Never mind.
Okay. So we haven't used equations 3 and 4. So you're saying solve for y, and but I take that you mean in equation 4?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So solve for y in 4, so I'll use 4. get 4y is 6x squared minus 2x. And where, what are we going to do when, so what, I'll observe something, and that is that if I divide by 4, then I have fractions, and fractions make us sad.
So you want to solve for x.
No, solving for x would be even worse, because, so you could solve for y. I'm not sure I understand what you're asking.
I'm not sure I do.
So what, if we were to solve for y, so I'm trying to help you see something so that you can strategize and plan ahead when you're trying to solve exercises like this. If we were to solve for y in here, what is it that we would do next? Okay, I agree with that. But what I mean,
once we have it, we would plug y back into the third equation.
Into third equation.
Correct.
Okay, so the third equation has a 2y in it, doesn't
it?
No.
So then you get a 6y.
The third equation has a 2y in it. So how about we take this equation and solve for 2y?
Oh. Even better.
Yeah, if we divide by 2.
Because that won't get way more confusing than this already
is. Is this confusing?
Yeah, that is confusing to me. I'd rather just solve for the variable and then plug it back in.
And then
that leaves me with ugly
y'all
fractions.
Y'all have fun with those fractions.
But I'd rather do that. Stressful for me.
Okay. I'm just trying to broaden everyone's horizons. So what I want you to see is that in equation 3 you can replace the 2y with that, because that's 2y. And so that's what I'm going to do. So that'd be x plus 3x squared minus x minus 12. Okay, so then x minus x, those cancel. Move the 12 to the other side, and you get 3x squared is 12. So x squared is 4. So what are the solutions? Right. X is negative 2, or x is 2. So are these the stationary points we were looking for?
No.
No, because that's the 8th time I've asked that question. What do we need to do now? Not second partials.
No. We need to solve for y and land. Well, we
yeah.
just solve for y.
Solve for y.
Yeah, we need to figure out what y is.
Something
right?
Or 2y.
Which equation, though?
Well, any of them. You could use this one. You could use that one. Anything
I like
where you have y's and x's. So now we'll determine y. Determine. Determine the y's. So when.
Oh, into one of the equations that you just. I got it.
Yeah, that we've already used. So like that one, or that, or whatever. So. So that'd be negative 2 plus 2y minus 12 is 0. So I'm using equation 3. So 2y is 14, so y is 7. So one of the stationary points is negative 2 comma 7. That's one of them. When x is the other point, the other value, we have 2.
Can you use the same equation though?
Yes.
Okay.
2 plus 2y minus 12 is 0. So that's 2y is 10. So what's y?
5.
5. So the other stationary point is 2, 5. Okay, now we started this exercise, you know, long time ago. Is this the answer? Is this what we were trying to do?
Nope.
No, it's not. What were we trying to do? Find the min and the max.
So seriously, is one of these going to be, are there multiple of these on the quiz? Because it seems like it takes longer than
it does take a long time. I'm aware that it takes a long time.
I was just curious. There's only going to be one on the quiz because I may not make it through.
But I have a question.
Yes?
So when we solve for the y, how do we get x? I'm just a little confused.
Okay, so are you? Where are you? Where are you okay to? Here?
Well, we got x is equal to 2, or x is equal to negative 2. I thought we were solving for y.
We are. So what I'm doing is I'm saying when x is negative 2, and I'm going to put it into equation 3.
Are you confused way back at, like, 2? Or, not 2, but, like, the find 3?
I have no idea. Sorry.
Okay, so... You're okay here?
Yeah. No, that's
what I'm talking about. Okay, I see. We solved for y in terms of x, and then we plugged it into equation 3, and then when you do that, you have eliminated y. So here's the equation, and it doesn't have any y's in it anymore. Yeah, so the whole process is that if you had 10 variables, you'd perform some work so that you could eliminate one and then have 9. And then you'd perform some more work so you could eliminate 1 and then have 8. And then work and then have 7. Until you get it down to just 1. And then you start doing the process in reverse to figure out the identities of all the other things. So we started with 3 variables. Then we got down to 2. Then we got down to 1. Then we figured out the values of the x's. And now we're undoing what we did to figure out the values of the y's. Other questions? Okay, so it says find the min and the max. So remember what the Lagrange's theorem says, that the min and the max, if they exist, must be among these stationary points. And furthermore, in this class, we take out the contingent clause if they exist. So in this class, if I say find the minimum, then you are assured it exists. Or if I say find the maximum, you are assured that it exists. So I say find the min and the max. So
they exist.
So they exist. Evidently, one of these is the min, and the other is the max. So we have 2 stationary points. One is the min, and the other is the max. But how do we tell? Yes. In the end, remember what this method is doing, what this method does for you, is that it optimizes the objective. We found 2 points, so you plug these 2 points into the objective. Whichever one is bigger, that's the max. Whichever one is smaller, that's
it's
the
not
min.
It's positive and negative.
It's not that.
Okay, because I'd already solved them. I was like, well, wait, there's no.
Right. So the positive and negative thing, you're having a false memory from what?
Well, not having a false memory. I'm having a memory from calculus 1. Second derivative test.
Of the second derivative test. Positive and negative concavity tells you min and max.
I was applying it to this, and that was obviously wrong.
Okay. So how to tell? is the question I just asked, and the answer is with the objective function. So f evaluated at negative 2.7. You said you already did it?
Mm-hmm.
What is it?
160.
160. Okay, and then f evaluated at 2.5?
57.
57?
Yes.
That doesn't...
No, I did math in my head. I did adding. Oh, no, because I didn't multiply. It's way higher than that. I added and not multiplied.
Okay.
4 times 25.
And then 128.
Yeah, I think it's 128.
I did math in my head.
Okay, so we found two stationary points and plugged them into the objective. So what's the conclusion?
That there's a max at -2.7.
Yes, so there's a max at -2.7. With value 160, and there's a min at 2.5 with value 128. Any question about this one? Any question before we go to something completely different?
Wow. For our third variable, we use whatever letter, right?
I'm sorry?
Like, we had x, y, and then for the third variable, we use whatever.
Whatever letter you like. But
you don't have to use lambda?
No, you don't have to use lambda. However, so there's a couple things. So first, obviously, is that don't use a letter that is already being used, right? Like don't use little x and capital X, for example, right? Don't do that. Another thing is that do understand that anytime you stray from convention, right? You risk confusing the grader. Right. So if you use say an M for your multiplier, then the grader's going to look at that real close and say, okay, they're using an M. But then you risk the grader looking really close at your paper. Right. I'm just saying. You want the grader to just be kind of just. In the zone, you know, just zoned out. Don't make them scrutinize you too closely. Okay, so no questions before we move to different thing. Okay, so we're in section 9.5, and it is called differentials. And approximations. So this is a calculator section. Okay, so from calculus one, so we're going to do very quickly, we're going to review and do an exercise of the calculus one version of this task. And then we're going to do the calculus two version of this task. So from calculus one, if you have y is f of x, then the differential dy is the derivative of f dx. Okay, so this is either from your calculus one time or from not that long ago, because we did it. So for example, I could say y is x squared plus e to 8x. Please compute dy. So it's derivative of the thing, and then dx. So it, in the end, it has to look like this. So what goes in the parentheses?
2x.
Good. So, any question about this one?
Why did you not write
it? Why do I write the 8 in the
No, bond? Why is there a blank spot above it?
Just so if anyone looks at the notes, they might remember that we talked about that.
Okay.
Why did you write the 8 after the
E? Yeah, why? Yeah, I guess.
Okay, now we're going to ask that. Okay, so let me write this. So this is the pattern that it has to take.
Got it.
Okay. And then the reason why I do this, and in fact most mathematicians write it like this subconsciously, is that later when you're computing derivatives of things, this matters. The order matters. So like the derivative with respect to t of e to, say, at, where t is a matrix, will be e to at times a. And when you're multiplying matrices, the order matters, and that's the right order.
Are we doing that?
No. So here this is scalar multiplication, and the order doesn't matter. Scalar multiplication commutes.
Can you put the 8 before the e to the 8?
Yeah, you could do that. That's no problem. What I'm saying is that eventually when you replace 8 with more interesting things like cats and things like that, the order matters. But it doesn't matter in our class. Okay. I lost my spot. Okay. Now where am I? Okay. Yes. So. Now. These dy's and dx's. The typical way that this is described in calculus 1 is as follows. I'm going to draw a picture. So we've got some nice calculus 1 function. And then now I'm going to choose favorite point x. So this is our favorite point right there. And if this is function f, then visually you can see what the value of f of x is by just extending this up to here. So that right there. So this value right here. Well, I can only really draw straight lines up and down.
Oh.
or at least that's how I'm most effective. So this height right here is f of x. Okay, now, let's suppose that this fence post is mobile. So I can grab this vertical one and I could move it around. Let's put another one over here, say. So we have some new point on the function. And let's say that this new point, what we did is we moved a distance from the other point, a distance of delta x. That is to say that this distance right here is delta x. Now, the red function is smooth, which means that what kind of thing do we have here at this point? Since red is smooth and not pointy. A tangent line. So at least according to my eye, it looks something like this. So we've got a tangent line. And we have yet another point that we need to keep track of. So this one right here. Okay. Almost done with the picture. So what is this value? So this height, this is f of x, is what this one is. What's this one?
F of x plus delta x.
Yes, f of x plus delta x. Okay, now, I'll say, to modify this just slightly, I'll say that this is y is f of x. So then this vertical distance, since we're calling this horizontal distance delta x, what do you think we're going to call this vertical distance?
Delta.
Delta y. But because of the way the diagram is drawn, you actually have a formula for delta y. What's the formula for delta y? Yes.
F of x delta x minus f of x.
Yeah. Okay. So now here's where it starts to get interesting. Oh yeah, it's getting good now. So now what, we're going to give a name to this height. We're going to give a name to this height right here. But before we do that, I'd like to point out what the fundamental idea of calculus is, the differential point of view, in case you hadn't caught it yet. Okay, so this is the idea. You can see the red and the blue functions there, and they're not very close, maybe, you know, by some reckoning of close. Now, if I shrink delta x, and I'll use my piece of paper to change the size of delta x. If I shrink delta x, I'd like for you to observe this distance right here. It gets as close as you want, right? So, big, small. Big, small. That's the idea of calculus, is that that tangent line, this tangent line, can be as good of an approximation as you want, as long as you're close enough. Right? So maybe for your purposes, red and blue are now close enough. Maybe that's close enough. Maybe that's close enough. But they can be made arbitrarily close. Okay? So, now this horizontal distance also has another name. It is also called dx, especially when it's quite small. Okay, so then now what is this vertical distance right here? So this one is delta y. What's this one?
dy.
So that one is dy. So taking these things down here, these formulas from the diagram, we can see that delta y is f of x plus delta x minus f of x. That's the formula for delta y. What is the formula for dy? What's the formula for dy? No. What's the formula for dy?
The derivative.
It's this one right here. So let's look at this. This shape right here is a right triangle. Okay? A right triangle. And you can find the slope of the hypotenuse of a right triangle by doing rise over run. Dy over dx is that slope. But on the other hand, this blue thing, what is it? It's a tangent line. It's attached at x. So this blue line must have slope. What's the slope of this blue line? The derivative evaluated at x. So rise over run, dy over dx is f prime of x. And one of the fundamental ideas of calculus is that you take these two, and when delta x is small, for some notion of small, delta y is approximately dy. So this statement right here, when delta x is small, delta y is approximately dy, that's what I'm doing here. Okay? Too big, that's okay. Too big, good. Too big, good. When delta x is small, the red and the blue are close. So that's like you've now taken the first half of calculus 1 in the last 10 minutes. Okay. So now, using this diagram, and the reason why we have to do this diagram so carefully is, first off, it's important, and second off, in a couple minutes we're going to do this with two variables. And it's going to be more interesting. we're going to draw such beautiful diagrams. Okay. So here's an example. So estimate estimate the square root of 16.01 using differentials. So in particular, I'd like to point out what the instructions do not say. The instructions do not say, type the square root of 16.01 into your calculator and write down whatever it says and nothing else.
So that will not get us the complete unknown number.
And right, I guess you have to.
If you get on one, that's just a complete SharePoint.
So using differentials, right? Okay, I just like to point that out. And even though I'm saying that, okay, statistically speaking, someone's going to do exactly that and turn in exactly that next week. Okay, now it says using differentials. So let's think about this for a minute. So first off, the square root of 16.01. What do you think that's probably close to?
Probably close to four.
And probably, would you say bigger than four or smaller than four?
Slightly bigger.
What's a number that this is surely less than?
Five,
right. So whatever the answer is, it needs to be between four and five. Okay. So the idea that we're going to do is the following. We're going to say, okay, we're going to use y is the square root of x. And we're going to use it in the following kind of way. So drawing this picture is not necessary to understand what we're doing. Drawing this picture is not necessary to get credit for an exercise like this, but it may be necessary to help you understand what's going on. So I'm going to draw y is the square root of x. And what's a number that's close to 16.01 that we definitely know the square root of?
16.
So I'm going to say that this here is 16. And then I'm going to move to the right a little bit, 0.01. But 0.01, if I was to try to make this to scale, it wouldn't look right. So I'm gonna draw it way further to the right so that you can see what we're talking about. So I'm going to say that this is 16.01. Okay, so then at the point that we know, I'm going to attach the tangent line. Okay, so then our estimate, what we're going to do is our estimate is going to be this value right here. So now, that being the case, this is our estimate, and this is the true value. Value. So that being the case, will our estimate be an underestimate or an overestimate? It'll be an overestimate. Okay. So what we're going to do is we're going to, instead of measuring delta y directly, because if we knew delta y, then that would tell us the true value. Instead of using delta y, what are we going to use?
Dy.
Dy. We're going to use dy is approximately delta y. Okay, so we'll need dy. So y is the square root of x. So what is dy? So what's the derivative of square root x? Yes, 1 over 2 square root x. So that's something that, memorizing that the derivative of x is 1 over 2 square root x, that's something that is flatly in your interest to memorize. Computing the square root, the derivative of square root, is so common that this is something that it's worthwhile to commit to memory. Otherwise, you could do it the long way and say, okay, well, the square root of x, that's fractional exponent half, and then take the half and move it to the front, and then subtract 1 to get negative half. The fact that the exponent is negative means you can put it in the denominator, so it's 1 half times 1 over x to half, but x to half is square root, which is this. So that's dy. Okay, and now here's the trick, and this is what the estimate is. We're going to evaluate dy at x is, so the point that we know, so what point is it that we know? 16. And dx is how far we are away from the point that we know. So dx is 0.01. We're going to evaluate dy there. So when you do that, dy is 1 over 2 square root 16 times 0.01. So that'd be dy is 1 over 8 times 0.01. But 0.01 is 1 over 100, so dy is 1 over 800. So is 1 over 800 our answer?
No.
No, right? Because we established at the very beginning, before we did anything, that our answer needs to be between what and what?
4 and 5.
4 and 5. So what is the answer? Alternatively, what is dy? What does it represent? It's how much you went up
from
the square root of 16. So the answer that we're looking for is y plus dy. So that would be, right, so being as verbose as possible. That would be 4 plus 1 over 800. So is that between 4 and 5? Ah, it is. So let's type that into the machine. So my calculator is reporting that this is 4.00125. Okay, now, what's a good way to check and see if this answer is reasonable?
Is it between?
Yeah, actually put that into your calculator. So the calculator says square root of 16.01. Calculator says 4.00129805. So was our answer, was our approximation a good approximation? It's pretty good. It's accurate to 5 significant figures and almost a 6th significant figure. That would be like saying, being accurate to your 6-figure salary to within a dollar. Pretty good, right? Any question about this? Yeah, this is all calculus one.
Oh, so yeah.
But I'm warming you up for doing this with two variables.
Yeah, this is
calculus one. Okay. So now let's do it with multiple variables. So definition. Given z is f of x and y, the differential dz is dz is the x partial dx. So far what I've written looks just like the differential in the calculus one case, right? It's the differential is a derivative times dx. But I said a derivative, right? A partial. What other partial is there? There's also a y partial, so we need to include that. So that'll be plus the y partial, and then what? dy. So this is the differential for multivariable case. So for example, if z is, how about x squared y cubed plus 4x minus 5y, then please compute dz. Okay, so just applying the formula, that would be dz is this expression, x squared y cubed plus 4x minus 5y, it's x partial dx plus this expression, x squared y cubed plus 4x minus 5y. It's y partial dy. Now, I'm not saying you need to write it out this way. You can probably do it without this step. But in the first place, I'll do it. So as for this first set, what is its x partial?
2xy cubed.
Yes?
Plus 4.
And then dx, and then plus the y partial of this, 3x squared y squared
minus 5
dy. Okay, any question about this? Yes, 3x squared y squared. Because x squared is a constant with respect to y. Okay, so now I'll say that's part one. And then part two, I want you to evaluate dz at. So now, in dz, how many different symbols are there? More than two? Four. Right? There's x and y, and also what else?
Dx and dy.
Dx and dy. So let's evaluate dz at, say, xy is 1, 2, and dx, dy is, say, 0.1, 0.3. And it's just as boring as it sounds. There's four numbers. Plug them all in there. Okay, so that'd be what? Two, and then a one, and then two cubed, plus four, times 0.1, plus 3 times 1 squared plus 2 squared minus 5 times 0.3. Okay, so I'll type that into the machine here. Okay, so I'm getting 4.1. Did anybody else do it? Got some 4.1s? Okay, good. Any question about this one? So you can imagine I could ask you other points too, right? Evaluate it here and there and everywhere, and how terrific that would be to do that. Okay. Let's have another. So how about W is x squared plus y cubed plus 5z. So please find dw. How many partials does W have?
Three.
So dW will be the sum of how many terms?
Three.
So then dw will be the x partial and then dx. So what's the x partial?
2x.
2x and then dx plus the y partial dy. So what's the y partial?
3y squared.
Yeah, 3y squared dy. And then plus the z partial dz. Okay, and I won't do it, but you could imagine I could say, now evaluated at x, y, z is blah, 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 and dx, dy, dz is blah, blah, blah. How many symbols is that?
Six.
Six, right, six of them. Okay. Any question about this? Dx, dy, dz.
Please
So now we're going to do the multivariable version of this diagram. Okay, and it's a little, there's a lot of moving parts, so you got to draw it carefully. Yeah, you got to draw big and carefully. So I practiced this earlier today. It takes.
You know what happened to my notes? Like, what the hell was I doing right there? On multiple occasions.
Okay, so here's our sort of stereotype calculus function, multivariable function. So x, y, and z, and then some kind of puddle where it's defined. And then over the puddle, it's some nice looking wavy thing here. So there's our stereotyped multivariable function.
So you're saying we need to draw this larger, is that what you're saying?
I have to draw a lot of little ones, because I can't draw it all in one big thing, because it'd all be on top of each other. So now, just like we did on the diagram, we're going to choose our favorite point. So here's a point. Some point. And I'm going to take this point up to the surface. Right there. So now, the calculus one diagram is we took that point where we started, and the fundamental idea is that you're sort of wiggling it. You move it to a new position, right? And the distance that you moved was delta x. So now the thing is, and the complication here is that now we have more than one direction to travel, right? We can travel in the x direction, that is to say in and out of the page. We can travel in the y direction, parallel with the page. Okay? So then that means that instead of an interval, instead of the delta x thing sort of representing an interval, now we have a little rectangle. Okay, so then what I mean by that is that you travel that much. This little measurement down here is delta x. That's the delta x measure. And then you can travel this much in the y direction. So that's the delta y measure. And then if you take these up to the surface, then on the surface, you'll see some little patch. So that's a curvy patch that's on top of this rectangle down here. Okay, so now we're not just interested in this rectangle. We're interested in all the rectangles. So I need to draw another version of this. Okay, so now the idea is, okay, we're going to take this We're going to take this puddle where we're defined, and we're going to chop it up into pieces. Okay, so we cut it into little pieces, and now we can watch what all these cuts do to the surface up here. So you'd see something like this, maybe. So those would be the red up at the top, and then the green, maybe something like this. They've gone to plaid. So we're interested in every one of these little patches, and these patches down here are in correspondence to the ones up here. So like maybe this patch right here corresponds to this patch up here. Okay, so now what we're going to do is we're going to take these two ideas, and what I want you to imagine, that I can't draw it because it'd be entirely too cluttered. Imagine that for every one of these little pieces over here, I have one of these sticks, one of these little volumes. So this whole volume is filled with these. Now I'm going to take these two points of view, and I'm going to combine them. So this kind of idea and this kind of idea together and make one that looks like this. So this piece that we have is some kind of curvy patch. So this is supposed to be a piece of the surface, and it's curvy. That is to say, it's not flat like a plane. Okay, now this point down here, this point in the back, this is point XY. That's our favorite point. And then what we're going to do is we're going to get to this point in the front. We're going to get to the point in the front. And the way we're going to get to the point in the front is we're going to travel along the X direction a distance of delta x, and then we're going to travel in the y direction a distance of delta y. Okay, to get to that point in the front. So what are the coordinates of that point in the front? Yes, x plus delta x and y plus delta y. And I didn't write it on these yet. I guess I'll write it now. This function we're talking about is z is f of x and y. Okay, now this point right here, what is the height of this point?
Sorry, really quick. The point at the front is x plus delta x,
comma, Oh, yes.
No, I was behind in this.
X plus delta x, yes. Oh, let's just cross that out. Okay, so this is x plus delta x, comma, y plus delta y. Okay, so this point is x, y. What's this point right here? Right. So I'll just write f of x and y. Okay. What is this point right here?
F of x plus delta x.
Yes.
Y delta y.
So that's f of x plus delta x, x, comma, y plus delta y. Okay, so now we're going to define the same in the same way that we did in the calculus 1 case. We're going to define delta z is what? So just like we did on this diagram, by analogy to this, what's going to be delta z? Right. This one minus that one. So what that means is that if you were over the point x, y, and then you moved until you were on top of the point x plus delta x, y plus delta y, delta z is how your elevation would change. Okay. In my picture, it appears to me that we would have gone down a little bit. So delta z would be negative, moving from this point to that point, but just in my picture. Okay, now, the tangent to this point is what kind of thing? What? A plane, right? A plane. So now I'm going to draw the tangent plane. Okay. Kind of hard to draw. My brain kind of wants to rebel with all the pictures. So, what you're seeing here is that this, let me strategically erase some things. So this surface on the top is flat. So this is flat. And again, this is in the back point xy. This is delta x. or no, we're not going to call this delta x. We're going to call this dx. Dx. And what are we going to call this one?
Dy.
Dy. Okay, and this point here at the top is still f of x and y. And what we want is we want to estimate the change moving from this point in the back to this point in the front. We want to estimate the change in elevation. And what are we going to call that estimated change in elevation? Not delta z,
dz.
And so now here's the question, is how do you do that? Sorry? Ah, yes. So then, let's look. Let's look. So then, in the back, on the back face of this, so on the back face, this is a right triangle, right? It's a right triangle. And what is the slope of the hypotenuse of this triangle right here? What's its slope? It's the partial with respect to y, because that's the y direction. So this slope, the slope of that hypotenuse is the y partial. How about this triangle that's on the left face? And it has a hypotenuse. The x partial. So dz, the way you can compute it is you follow the hypotenuses? I'm not sure. You follow the hypotenuses of in the x direction and then in the y direction. So how much does z change when you are only traveling in the x direction? Well, it'll be the slope of the x hypotenuse multiplied by dx. So it'll be the x partial dx. And then when you get from here to here, then what do you have to do? Now you change direction to the y direction, and you follow that hypotenuse. So you get an additional change. So what's the additional change?
The y partial.
Dy. And what is that? That's the formula for the differential that we wrote on the previous page. We did just do this, but now you know why the formula is the way it is. Right? You're probably in a good place. But I'm gonna ask questions that if that's all that you can do, it'll strain your understanding. You have to know it from all directions. So any question about this? So, by the way, when you take a box, a rectangular prism, like this, and then you cut it with a plane, like we have here. So we took a rectangular prism and cut it, and that's what this is. Then this flat surface is a shape. It's always a certain kind of shape. What kind of shape is this? So what is this? It's not a rectangle.
Diamond.
Not a diamond.
Trapezoid.
I'm fishing for a P word.
Parallelogram.
Nice job. It's always a parallelogram. It has two L's in it. Where is it? Is it the first one? Okay. Parallelogram. So now we'll get to this, but just as a matter of foreshadowing, remember that in calculus 1, right, we talked about what what integral was, and we said, ah, shapes, the way, at least from the calculus point of view, they're actually composed of infinitely many infinitesimal rectangles. That's what shapes are. Okay? Now, in not too long from now, we're going to ask, well, what is the volume that is under this surface? Right? Just like we asked, what's the area under a curve, we're going to ask, what's the volume under a surface? And what we're going to do is we're going to say, well, volumes are actually consist of infinitely many infinitesimal cubes, rectangular prisms, right? Little volumes. You know those things that are at the mall where some child always pushes their face into it and it has all those things and then their face remains? Or you can put a hand in it. You know what I'm talking about, right? Where you push that? Like one of those. Except there's the needles are now infinitely fine. Okay, just like that. So we're going to cut such volumes into infinitely many infinitesimal rectangular prisms and then find the volumes of them and add them all up. It's going to be terrific. now the surface, if you wanted to find the area of the surface, right, because knowing the area of something is important. If you wanted to find the area of a surface, as far as mathematicians are concerned, surfaces are constructed of infinitely many infinitesimal parallelograms. So if you knew the formula to compute the area of a parallelogram, then you could find the area of anything, the surface area of any surface, by just cutting it up into infinitely many infinitesimal parallelograms. So that's the like the fundamental idea of calculus from the integral point of view, is you take an object that you like rectangles or rectangular prisms or parallelograms, something you can deal with. And then you cut whatever other object that you're interested in into infinitely many infinitesimal of those. And then integrate. Terrific. Any question about the explanation of the differential? Okay. So let's do a problem now, an exercise. So, for example, estimate the square root of 2.98 squared plus 4.01 squared using differentials. Okay, and I hope that you see at least superficial similarity to the question that we did about the square root of 16.01. Right? So if that was the question, then it would be quite similar to the previous one, right? Okay. So what do you think? What are we gonna do? Sorry? Close to 7. No, it won't be close to 7. Square root doesn't do that. It won't be close to 3 plus 4. Now, this is close to 3, and that's close to 4. If it was 3, then this would be 9, and this would be 16, the sum of which is 25, the square root of which is 5. So our answer should be close to 5. Close to 5. Should be close to 5. So what will we do? What will we do? Yes. We will use, we'll come up with a new relationship that does this. So how about z is square root of x squared plus y squared? Because we've got some thing squared and some other thing squared. Okay, now this is a function of two variables. Z is a function of two variables. And we're going to do this, we're going to use this z at what xy point? So what xy point is near the point in question that seems particularly convenient?
3, 4.
Okay, how about at xy 3, 4? And then, besides that, we'll also have, what did we call it on the previous exercise? I just want to make sure to... Yeah, okay. So we'll use dx, dy is what? So what's dx? No, no, no. That would be the differential of x squared.
One, dx and dy are one.
Okay, let's back up just a little bit. So I have a question on the calculus one version of this exercise that we did. So this is the calculus one version. We said we're gonna do this at x is 16 and dx is 0.01.
Oh.
Now on this exercise, why did we choose
0.01? Because it was the difference.
Yeah,
so it's -0.02.
Yes.
0.01.
Yes. -0.02 and 0.01. Any question about why that's the selection for our point x, y, and our differences dx and dy?
So you've got the 0.01 from 4.0?
Yes, because the calculation here is that dx is 2.98 minus x, and dy is 4.01 minus y. So we selected for x, we chose 3. So 2.98 minus 3 is that value.
Negative 0.02.
Mm-hmm.
And then when you plug in the 4 to 5, you get
0.01. Yes? No? Okay, so what are we going to do then?
Find the x partial and the
partial. Right, so we're going to use dz. Because dz is our estimate for delta z. So that means we need to compute dz. So dz will be square root x squared plus y squared, x partial of this dx, plus square root x squared plus y squared, y partial of this dy. Okay, so then what is the x partial of square root x squared plus y squared? So this is again an instance of the derivative of square root of u. So this is something that is in your interest to memorize. 1 over 2 square root u du dx, yes. So the x partial of this would be 1 over 2, that square root thing, and then multiplied by x squared plus y squared, the x partial of that dx, plus 1 over 2 square root x squared plus y squared x squared plus y squared, y partial of that, dy. So what is the x partial of x squared plus y squared? 2x. So 2x times this. Confused?
Yep.
I am confused. How did we get, so I thought we were doing the x partial.
Okay. So I'm halfway through writing this line. So what's your question?
I'm still on the line up ahead.
This one?
Uh-huh.
Or this one?
Nope, the middle one.
This one's okay?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this one.
How do we get there?
So we're computing the x partial of that.
Right.
So this is, that's u.
Okay.
The formula is 1 over 2 square root u. Du dx.
Okay.
1 over 2 square root u.
Mm-hmm.
Du dx.
Okay.
Is it really okay? I'm not.
You're not convinced.
I'm not getting. I'm not sensing that it's okay.
So is it u substitution? Is that what we use to get?
No, I'm using the chain rule.
The chain rule, okay. Okay, that makes more sense. You're using the chain rule. But how come, are you just doing it in an extra step? Maybe that's why I'm confused. I'm not sure, just continue on. It's fine.
Well, see, the thing about, one of the things about teaching is that there's a couple of things.
I understand, but I don't know how to articulate what I'm not understanding, so I don't think there's any way that you're going to be able to get there with me.
Maybe.
Okay.
But this is the thing.
Can you rewrite down the chain rule?
This is the chain rule right here.
Yeah. Du, don't know what that means.
Du dx, that means the derivative. So the derivative of square root of inside is 1 over 2 square root inside multiplied by derivative of inside.
I understand. So the x squared, y squared, you just haven't taken the x partial yet of them.
What?
Yeah.
There. Okay. I'm there. I'm there with you now.
You took the derivative of it on the third.
Right. So I have x squared plus y squared and then x partial of it.
Right. I understand what's going on and why I'm confused.
So we're okay?
We
can move on.
Well, you have to have an unambiguous way to do it.
Right.
But historically, the reason why is that many separate groups worked on what eventually was collected all together under the same notion of derivative. So you've got the you know, continental Western Europeans who were doing it. You've got the British, okay, non-continental Europeans who were doing it. You've got other groups. There's just people all over the place.
So that's why it's a little bit, okay.
And so there's momentum with all of that. It's like in English, we have, for some concepts, we have like five words that mean the same thing. Same story here.
Okay.
Okay, so then plus 1 over 2 square root x squared plus y squared times 2y dy, and then maybe just a little bit of simplification. So this is x over square root x squared plus y squared dx plus y over square root x squared plus y squared dy. So we're okay to here. Okay. So now what do we do with this differential? Yeah, we're going to evaluate. Evaluate dz at xy is 3, 4, and dx dy is negative 0.02, comma 0.01. Okay. Well, so that'd be dz is 3 divided by, and let's think about that for a second. So what's x squared plus y squared at 3, 4? 25, the square root of which is 5. So this would be 3 over 5. Multiplied by negative 0.2. And then plus 4 over 5 times 0.01. And that's probably as good as we need to get it before using the calculator. So the calculator, 3 over 5 times, oops, I wrote 0.2, but that needs to be 0.02. So this thing I'm writing in red, I had originally copied incorrectly. Small number.
A small number, I know. That's what I got too.
Okay. So that would be, I'm getting, so let me read it aloud. So I'm getting negative 4 zeros and then 9 6. Mm-hmm. No? Did I type it wrong? Okay, just a sec.
Negative 0.004.
What am I doing? Oh, I left off. Okay, now I have. Okay, now that's right. So negative 0.004.
How did you get that? I get negative 0.012. So 3 divided by 5 times negative 0.02, right?
Mm-hmm. Plus.
Oh, I didn't fit. Oh, yes. I'm sorry. That was the final answer. Oh. I didn't realize. That's right there.
Okay. So, is this the answer to the question?
No.
No. So, what's the answer to the question?
Oh, man.
I honestly have no idea how to interpret that information.
So, this is how much you change in elevation moving from 3-4 to the point that we want to be at. So, the answer that we want is z plus dz. So we need to evaluate that. So that is the square root of x squared plus y squared, and then plus this thing, x over square root x squared plus y squared dx, plus y over square root x squared plus y squared dy. So we want to evaluate that at the point in question. Well, that would be 5 plus negative 0.004.
Where do you get 5?
Because that's the square root of 3 squared plus 4 squared.
Gotcha.
So that would be 4.996. So, how can we check and see if this is a reasonable answer? Yeah, we could plug in that thing into the calculator now. Well. So if you type it into the calculator is giving this number, 4.9960. So we have 5 digits of accuracy.
I'll take it.
The 48439 is how much we were off by. Okay, now you might, and even actually did object to, why do we just do that? Why didn't we just type it in the calculator? Well, I have a question for you. What is this calculator doing?
It's
How's the calculator doing it?
That, like that.
Yeah, more or less like this. You know, you might ask, like, no, I mean, it's a legitimate question, right? So then that it's probably unlikely that you're going to use calculus in your daily lives.
I would bet a lot of money on that.
It's a little bit, it's somewhat unlikely, okay, that you're going to do that. It's not impossible, okay? Then you might ask, well, why are we doing this at all?
Because we have to.
Okay, so from your point of view, the answer is because I have to.
Yeah.
It might be in that lifeboat.
Yeah, lifeboat.
We're going to die. But I won't have to log all the log at the logbook, so I won't be able to.
I see what you say.
No, I mean, this is a state school, okay? It's a state school. Okay, a state university. Our curriculum is largely mandated by state legislature. Okay.
I do not know anyone who's gotten a business degree, not ATD, that has had to take this class.
UTR Arlington doesn't require.
Doesn't require.
No,
calculus.
Not Cal 2. No, UTA just Cal 1.
But UTA is not giving you a bachelor's of science. UTA is giving
okay.
you a bachelor's of the business administration.
Okay. So.
Not that I looked it up.
So why at all? Why does state governments, okay? Apparently human beings as a group think that y'all in particular, okay, need to take calculus. Why is that?
The first one makes sense. I can see finding the derivative of something. But this
there's
actually
two there's
to help us think critically.
That is the main reason.
Critical thinking.
Learning how to think analytically, critically. Very important skill.
What's that? Is that I can't write papers to save my life.
It's not that. Everybody can stand to improve their analytical and critical thinking. That's the reason.
Now,
it does.
We've got a computer program that does it for us, but our server switch went out last week, or yesterday. Well, I know, but you know.
Okay, we gotta move on. Okay, so another one. So. So another purpose for this topic is that differentials are used to estimate error propagation. So if we were given z is f of x and y, and we wanted to measure something, say, like if z was product x, y, so like maybe we were making tiles. And the product of x and y would represent what about the tile? Sorry? So what if x is one measurement, if it's a rectangular tile, if it's one measurement and then y is the other measurement, then what does x, y represent? Yeah, and the product would represent area, right? So now the question is suppose we're manufacturing such tiles and we want them to be 3x5. That's the what's supposed to come off the assembly line, but in fact, they come off the assembly line with small errors. Right, a little bit longer sometimes, a little bit shorter sometimes in one direction or in the other. How did those errors in those linear measurements affect the error in the area of the tile? Okay, so given z is f of x and y, and errors dx and dy, then the absolute error estimate is dz. The relative error estimate is dz divided by z, and the percent error estimate is dz over z times 100%. Okay, so for example, suppose that we're making cylinders. So we're making cylinders. And that in our process, the height is 42 plus or minus 0.9, and the radius is 2.5 plus or minus 0.2. So then estimate the absolute, relative, and percent errors. In the volume. Okay. So that means that you got to know what a cylinder is. And you got to know the formula for the volume. So what is the formula for a volume of a cylinder?
Pi
r squared h. The volume of a cylinder is the volume of the base, pi r squared, multiplied by h. So that being the case, what are we going to use to estimate the absolute? So here it says in the remark up here, in the abstract remark, what gives you the absolute estimate?
dz,
if the quantity was z. So what's going to be the absolute error estimate in this case?
dv.
We're going to do dv, and we're going to do it at what point? Yes, at HR is 42 and 2.5. But what else will we also need?
DH and DR.
Yes, DH and DR. So DH and DR are what? Yeah, 0.9 and 0.2.
Does it matter that it's plus or minus?
No. So this represents the worst case scenario.
Okay.
So that means that you're off by at most that much.
Yeah.
So then we want to evaluate dv. at this position. So that means we need to determine dV. So I'll give you a moment. Please calculate dV. Okay, so dV, that was a quick moment, huh? So what's the H partial? Well, it doesn't matter, but I happen to write them down, H and then R first, so I'm going to do H. Pi R squared, and then dH. And then plus the R partial, what's that?
2RH, oh, pi 2RH.
Okay, good. And then dr. Okay, so then we want to plug in all that stuff. So let's plug that in. So pi. I got 149, is that right? DH 2 times 2.5. Okay, so I get 149, is that right?
Hold on.
Oh, we're waiting? Okay.
You don't have to wait for me, but I'm not there yet. So.
Well, I don't even know what the answer is if it's not 149. I usually wait for someone to confirm. Okay. So plugging that in, that's 149. Point, yeah, 618. Okay, so now, the absolute error can be helpful, but it's not always helpful. Sometimes it's hard to understand whether or not 149 is big or not. Right. So then if you're trying to land an aircraft and you're within 149 feet, that might be all right as long as it's down the runway, right? If you're within 149 miles, that's not going to work, right? You have to be more accurate than that. If you're within 149 inches, then you're incredible. Right? How did you get that close to being right on the spot? Okay, so the relative error helps understand whether or not the absolute error is big. So what is the on this exercise, what is the formula for the relative error?
Oh, dV over Z, sorry.
dV over V, right.
Oh, dV over V.
dV over V at the same point. Which really is not a big deal because it's just the previous answer divided by something new. So dV over V. Divided by. So I'm getting 0.18142-ish. And so now the percent is what? Yeah, this thing that we just did times 100%. So then dv over v times 100% is 18.142%, which maybe is a lot, maybe it's not, depending on your problem, right? So being within 18% is not good if you're talking about your monthly budget, but it's pretty good if you're talking about standing from 5 miles away and with your eyes only estimating the mass of a mountain. If you can get within 18%, that's incredible. Wow. Okay, so one last thing before we before we go. So this is just for foreshadowing, so we can get to it quickly on Thursday. So this is called iterated integrals. And we'll just do one of them. Okay, please compute the antiderivative of 4x y squared plus 5y dy. So what does this mean? There's only one variable.
It's y.
There's two letters. Yeah.
Y is the only variable.
Y is the only thing that's varying. X is constant with respect to y. So please compute the antiderivative of this, holding x to be constant. So what's the antiderivative of the first term with respect to y? Okay, good. 4x is a constant. So then y cubed over 3. Plus, what's the antiderivative of the second term?
5x.
Okay. So then now you need to add a constant. But it's not a constant in the same way that it used to be. Now, it has to be constant with respect to what? With respect to y. No, it only needs to be constant with respect to y, which means it can depend on x. So now, it's plus c of x. Now it's a constant function with respect to x.
Before you continue, is this an example of calc 1, or is this an example of calc 2?
This is calculus
1.5.
So this is exactly what you were doing with the antiderivatives before, except now x is a constant with respect to y, but the constant of integration right here now is a function which depends on x. So if we had been anti-differentiating with respect to y, and there were 5 other variables, then the constant would be a function of all of those 5 variables.
So you see x.
Yes. And so this is what we're going to do next time. Have a nice Tuesday.